We're back on Let's Have It Out. We have a caller from Port Elizabeth. His name is Zenzile. What's up, Zenzile? What is your question?
Hi, advocate, how are you?
Good, good.
My question, advocate, is about the South Africa situation. How can you advise the government of South Africa when now they're discussing to take the land back from the white farmers? Because my fear as a person is that we have seen this happening in Zimbabwe when the government was taking land, food and then agriculture process then declined. The economic declined. Now my fear is that, okay, let me make an example of the grape farmers. If you can say, let's take all these grape farmers to the black without giving this particular person a training, my concern is the training and the funding. That's my concern, advocate. Mm-hmm. How can you advise our government to do that?
Thank you, Zenzile. I suppose we should factor this question in our conversation. We are now in the final segment of our conversation. The caller has raised one important question, which is, you can't have land reform unless you've got skilled, competent people, especially that will improve the productive capacity of farms. Would you agree that those are the key lessons, one of the key lessons to be taken from the Zimbabwean situation?
Sure, we definitely agree that one of the most important aspects that the South African government should take into consideration this time around when they intend to undergo the land reform program or to get land is to make sure that the people that land is given to people that deserve the land, who have the knowledge and skill of how they can bring about the production that is required on the land. And also to make sure that they give land to people who do want to use it. It is important that over and above identifying those people, they should have the capacity also to invest on the land, because it is important that with the changes in the climate, there is need to have the right equipment that caters or that meets the demands of the climatic change of the day. And the other issue is also, there is also need to make sure that when land is given to people, they are given the title deeds. And the question of title deeds is a very important one, because it ensures that people have confidence in putting infrastructure on the land. But besides that, it gives them also what they might need to use as collateral when they go to the bank to borrow money, because it is not possible for us to go on the land without enough capital.
Now, to raise two other aspects, you were reluctant at the beginning, and perhaps you might have reconsidered your position about the importance of the rule of law. President Mnangagwa is now on record as having announced that the constitutional commitments and the compliance with the law is crucial for the future. Would you accept that the rule of law is crucial for any successful land reform program?
We definitely do agree that the rule of law is very important, because land redistribution should be done orderly to make sure that we accord those that are deserving the right to go onto the land. But let us, this is a lesson that we are drawing from the Zimbabwean context.
Yes.
Because when it happened in Zimbabwe, it had to happen that way.
Yes.
We had no other model from which to copy from. So whatever happened at that time, we draw lessons from that. And these are some of the lessons that we are saying, if we were to have another land reform, which is not going to happen in Zimbabwe, we would definitely do it differently. So we are giving lessons to South Africa so that they don't move in the same direction like we have done. But most importantly, the lesson that is critical for the South African government is to make sure that they should not procrastinate on the issue of land. It should be given now.
Thank you. We have Tobekile from Sunning Hill on the line. Hello, Tobekile. What is your question or comment?
Hi.
Hello.
Hello. My question is for Mr. Mandaza.
Sure. Carry on. Carry on, Tobegele, we're listening.
Okay. I would like to find out why they are only realizing now that there was a mistake with the land reform, because this happened about 18 years ago, and they are only they only want to correct it now after 18 years. Didn't they recognize this 18 years ago?
Well, thank you, Tobegile. So there are two aspects to the question. The first is that ZANU-PF had 20 years between 1980 and 2000 before it embarked on the process. The other is, after it embarked on the process, up until now, why did you not pick up these mistakes?
The first 20 years, like we have already indicated, we were following what we thought was right at that time, based on the constitutional requirements as stipulated during the Lancaster House conference. And when we go into, when we embarked into the land reform program, a number of things happened, and it did not happen only in 2000 and in the year 2000, but it took a number of years. And even then, during those years, there are a number of areas that people have tried to mitigate to make sure that land is distributed equitably to the majority of the people that are in Zimbabwe. It is not that we would want to correct it now. But the issue now is that we have come up with a land commission which is going to look into these issues and make sure that all the areas that needs to be attended to are attended to legally.
So, finally, it's clear that land reform is urgent, land reform is necessary, land reform is unavoidable. And I think you and I have reached a point of consensus that although it's unavoidable, it's necessary and it's imperative. The rule of law is equally important, and transparency around beneficiaries, so that it's not only the politically connected that benefit from the land reform, is also crucial. What's your final comment about the important lessons to be taken from Zimbabwe?
The other important lessons to be taken from Zimbabwe, besides the one that you have mentioned, is to make sure that people understand that the case that we have in South Africa is slightly different from the case that we had in Zimbabwe. The South African economy is based on mining and industry. And the majority of the people are predominantly in the urban areas. Therefore, there is pressure on the people getting land for housing. Whereas in Zimbabwe, the pressure was on land for agriculture. So it is important that the South African government, when it is embarking on the on land expropriation, they should consider, over and above the rule of law, transparency, and they should also make sure that they make sure that they do not disturb the linkages that are there in terms of agriculture and other areas that might disturb the economy of South Africa. Because it is critical that we maintain the level of productivity that is on the land. And besides that, let us also make sure that people that are going on the land, they are skilled, they have the resources, and they are ready to work the land. Besides that, there is nothing that we should not do with regards to the land.
Thank you, Kennedy. Well, that's it for this edition of Let's Have It Out. Remember to keep the conversation going on social media with the hashtag LHIO. Tomorrow night, my friend and colleague Dali Mpofu will be sitting in this chair. You don't want to miss that conversation. My name is Tembeka Ngcukaitobi. Good night.